Welcome to our overview on polymerase chain reaction. Here we will see the fundamentals for setting up these types of reactions in the lab. The purpose of PCR is to generate millions of copies of a specific gene of interest. For this technique, a tiny sample of the template DNA is placed in a test tube with buffer magnesium, deoxynucleotide triphosphates, DNTPs, primers, and the DNA polymerase. Then the sample is heated up momentarily, and the two strands of the template DNA separate. Then the DNA polymerase builds a new double helix from each strand, using the DNA primers as a starting place to add the new DNTPs. These two copies are then heated and duplicated, yielding four copies. After repeating this many times, many identical DNA strands are produced. Our own DNA polymerases and those from most organisms would be destroyed by the heating step in this process. But today, DNA polymerase from Thermus aquaticus, a bacterium that lives in hot springs, is used. This polymerase, shown in the picture here, is perfectly happy at 70 degrees centigrade and may be used throughout all of the PCR heating and cooling steps. Each round of PCR contains three major steps. The first is denaturation. This is where heat is used to denature and melt the DNA template into two single strands, usually done at 96 degrees Celsius. The next stage is annealing. This is where the sample is cooled to allow for the binding of the primers. Note that the primers are added at a relatively high concentration compared to the DNA template. This encourages the template to bind with the primers rather than to have the template re-anneal with itself and reform the double helix. The temperature of annealing can vary depending on your experiment and usually ranges between 52 degrees Celsius and 68 degrees Celsius. The third step is the extension step. This is where the DNA polymerase binds to the template and the primer and begins extending the new daughter strand of DNA. This is usually done at 72 degrees Celsius, the optimal temperature for heat-tolerant polymerases that are used especially for this technique. Each round of PCR represents a doubling of the last round. For example, one template creates two products, which replicate to 4, and then to 8, 16, 32, and so on. A typical PCR reaction will undergo 28 to 40 cycles. After 32 cycles, the gene of interest has been amplified around 4 billion times, or 2 to the 32 power. Specialized PCR tubes that have been siliconized are typically used for PCR. This helps keep all of the solution at the bottom of the tube during the heating and cooling cycles. The reaction must contain template DNA that contains the gene of interest, the forward and reverse primers specific for the gene of interest, the DNA nucleotide monomers, the DNA polymerase, and a buffer that contains magnesium, which is a required cofactor of the DNA polymerase. Here are a couple of examples of PCR thermal cyclers. Typically, there is a platform bed where the samples can be loaded, usually either 0.2 or 0.5 mL tubes or a 96-well plate. The lid is also heated to keep the sample from evaporating and condensing onto the lid of the tube. Each cycle is fully automated so that the experiment can run in the absence of the experimenter. The denaturing and annealing phases are usually around 30 seconds in length, and the extension times will vary depending on the size of the fragment being amplified, usually 1 kV or 1,000 bases per minute. A typical amplification can be done in 2 to 4 hours. The PCR product can be detected using agarose gel electrophoresis, followed by staining with ethidium bromide or other DNA intercalating agent. Be careful using these reagents in the lab. They can intercalate into your DNA as well and cause damage. Hence, they have carcinogenic potential. In the gel on the left, you can see that the staining intensity increases with the increasing amounts of DNA as the PCR cycles increase. In agarose gel electrophoresis, It's also common to run a standard ladder in one of the lanes. This allows you to judge the size of the PCR product to help you determine if it is the right size range for your anticipated product. DNA sequencing, after the product has been cloned, is required to confirm the identity and integrity of the product. These two simple DNA polymerases on the left are shaped roughly like a hand. Both are from bacteria. On the far left is the enzyme from E. coli. In the middle and on the right is the TAC polymerase from the Thermus aquaticus. A cleaved version of the E. coli enzyme is presented. The missing part is responsible for removing the RNA primer. It is shown with a green outline. The space in between the fingers and the thumb is just the right size for a DNA helix, but surprisingly, DNA actually fits into the palm when the enzyme is at work. In the picture on the left, the template strand is colored purple, while the new strand is colored green. The enzyme contains three active sites. The polymerase site near the top in these pictures synthesizes the new strand by adding nucleotides. The 3' to 5' exonuclease site near the center in the E. coli polymerase proofreads the new additions. The polymerase from the Thermus aquaticus does not have this proofreading ability. Perhaps the heat in which it lives performs the same function. At the bottom is the 5' to 3' exonuclease site that later removes the small RNA fragments that are used to prime DNA replication. This diagram compares some different PCR-based techniques. We have been learning conventional PCR in the upper diagram. In this scenario, the amplification products are analyzed at the end of the reaction, endpoint PCR, by gel electrophoresis, and detected after fluorescent staining. Quantitative PCR, qPCR, and digital PCR, dPCR, use the same amplification reagents and fluorescent labeling systems. In quantitative PCR, the amount of amplified DNA is measured at each cycle during the PCR reaction in real time. The absolute quantity of the target sequence is interpolated using a standard curve generated with a calibrator. In digital PCR, the sample is first partitioned into many subvolumes in microwells, chambers, or droplets, such that each partition contains either a few or no target sequences. After PCR, the proportion of amplification positive partitions serves to calculate the concentration of the target sequence using Poisson statistics. The PCR reaction may not work for a number of different reasons. Depending on the origin of the sample, inhibitors may be located directly in the test material, for example, isolation of DNA from the blood, or as a residue from the process used for the isolation and purification of the DNA. GC-rich sequences are also often difficult to amplify. This is due to high melting temperatures of the template and possible secondary structure that can form and impede the polymerase. Sometimes nonspecific or undesired products get amplified. Sometimes the polymerase error rate is too high, and the PCR fragment contains too many errors to be useful. This can happen when you're trying to recombinantly express a protein to study its activity. You want to make sure you have the wild-type protein and that errors have not been introduced during PCR. The amplification of very long templates can also be tricky. These are all considerations that you will need to address during your PCR reactions.